Labor once had business on side, but this week even the usually polite Australian Industry Group accused the Gillard government of risking driving business out of the country by giving unions too much and businesses nothing.
The traffic over the past 2 years has been all one way and it has all gone in the wrong direction.
Julia Gillard on Thursday tried to persuade the Business Council her government was good for business.
Take away the politics, look at what the market is saying about us. Three triple A's. Australia's budget is one of the seven economic wonders of the modern world.
Joining me are former Defence Minister Peter Reith and former Labor adviser Cassandra Wilkinson. Look, growth around 3%, unemployment, well, I think it's a bit too high, but people say it's fine at 5.5% nearly. She's got a case, isn't it? Seven wonders of the world.
She has a case that things are much better than a lot of people would make out. But the key challenge that we have is that while Labor sensibly insists on a role for unions in protecting basic conditions and pay, Labor has allowed the unions far too big a role in economic regulation. And so when we look at the lost opportunities in our economy, they are around things like the industry policy failures that have happened, throwing money at highly unionised industries in order to shore up the interests there, and not putting the same amount of attention into growing the areas where the opportunities are. So I think that while she's correct to be proud of Australia's position in the world at the moment, that's ignoring a whole lot of sensible reforms that are still yet to be done.
So your argument is it's good, could be better. Seven wonders of the world.
Well, this is hyperbole on a grand scale. Even Paul Keating, I don't think it goes that, you know, that far. I mean, one minute we've got the world's best treasurer, apparently, with Wayne Swan. We'll have Japanese tourists out the front, you know, wanting to see the great man. I mean, it really is just completely over the top. And as Ennis Willock said, you know, from AIG, he said, look, you know, strikes are up, productivity's down, flat, not going anywhere. All sorts of problems, for example, in the resources sector, which is sort of the goose that lays the golden egg for Australia's living standards.
And now it's just laying an egg instead.
Yeah, and the fact is we do have some problems. Sure, we're doing better than some other people, but that is not the issue. The issue is that Julia Gillard has sort of written out 120 checks, basically, which are all pro-union, and that is one of the problems underlying our capacity to improve productivity. If you don't have decent productivity, you don't have decent living standards. So that's the worry.
So I think we're on the same page here, that it's doing all right, but it should be doing a lot better. Now, I thought that she overcooked her speech to the Business Council on a couple of other fronts too. No one in that room, I think, would have agreed with her to say that when she claimed the budget has returned to surplus. That's not true. And I think that's particularly important, Cassandra, when we've just seen this week the government actuary costings suggest that the National Disability Insurance Scheme that the government has promised will not be costing $15 billion a year, which is already terrible. When it comes in, it'll be $22 billion a year, 50% more. How can we afford this?
Well, for the same reason that we could afford it at 7 is the reason we can afford it at 22, and that's because fundamentally we are spending a lot of public money on things no one needs. We are spending a great deal of money in the wrong places at the moment. So while to me the desperate need of families with children who have got disabled children is what's been left out of the NDIS debate, the problem with the NDIS, it's largely an insurance scheme, and it's not really grappling with the biggest problem, which is respite care for people whose children are born with a disability.
Look, no, I'm all
but
yes,
say, but there's
22
so much
billion.
Waste. So at the moment, when we look at how much money is spent on the health system, which has had no reforms done on it for 10 years, despite what Kevin Rudd said at COAG several years ago,
and Julia,
we look at the Gonski reforms, where once again we're going to have smaller class sizes at great expense with no evidence to back up the necessity for it. We're wasting money across so many projects. NDIS is a thing that should exist. The final cost,
yes,
I agree, needs to be sorted out. But
there are two issues here, Cassandra. One is, look, $22 billion is an unbelievable amount, is it not, Peter? And second, if you're going to actually run a scheme, don't tell the public it's $15 billion when it's $22.
Well, they haven't been honest with us. And the fact is that this number has come out because some bloke at CIS Andrew Baker, I think his name is.
Centre of Independent Studies.
Well, he's applied under FOI to actually get the real figures. Now, why didn't Julia Gillard have the decency to tell the Australian people beforehand what the costs were going to be? Everybody's in favour of doing something, but obviously, in the end, it's got to be paid for. And when we're already basically, you know, what, we've had 4 or 5 years of deficit under Labor, and it looks like deficits into the future, and that's a huge problem for Australia and for the business community. No wonder there's virtually no business person in Australia has got any time for Julia Gillard because she's not a good economic manager.
If I may say quickly, Andrew and I both wrote similar things about the NDIS, which is that if you go after family tax benefit B, if you go after the middle class welfare that both shades of government have been addicted to for too long, you can pay for it.
Well, then just tell the public that it's going to cost you $7 billion extra that we're going to take out of, well, say it. I think it's all at the moment on make-believe, a promise, unfunded, and they won't say where the money's coming from. But look, being critical of Julia Gillard, let me be praiseworthy. I thought her reaction to the rocket attacks on Israel and the threat now of Israel responding by an invasion of Gaza, where these rockets are coming from, 800 missile attacks in a year, was good. She said the attacks, the rocket attacks were utterly unacceptable. Hamas, which controls Gaza, should cease them immediately, and she supported Israel's right to defend itself. Foreign Minister Bob Carr doesn't seem to be on the same page, Cassandra. What's going on?
Well, I think that Labor federal leaders, particularly Beazley and Gillard, have always been very strong supporters of Israel and very strong supporters of the US alliance. And inside the Labor Party, it's very hard to unpick the two.
Except now we hear Foreign Minister Carr not saying Israel's got a right to defend itself and Hamas should stop immediately, saying restraint on both sides. They're not on the same page.
Yeah, well, I think Bob's probably spent too long with the left and right in New South Wales and thinks that you can be an independent peacemaker. But there are some issues on which you have to stand on one side or the other, and being in the middle on the Israel-Palestine issue I don't think is tenable. I think Julia Gillard is on the right side here.
Yeah, and so does this mean anything that Bob Carr is telling Israel, cool it, you know, I'm sure you've got rockets falling on Jerusalem and Tel Aviv, your two biggest cities, but restraint on both sides?
Well, you know, Bob was sort of touted as being, you know, going to be a first-class foreign minister, and he's done a few things in a positive way, but he had a few hiccups at the start, and a breach with Julia Gillard is no surprise to me, and he's going to have to clean that up, and if he doesn't, she's going to have to tell him. So, you know, she has taken the right line. I think that's absolutely fair, but she's got to make sure that the, you know, that the ones down the line follow the line that she's taken.
I would have thought so too. Tim Matheson, her partner, has been kept out of the limelight by Labor's advisers for some time. He sprang out of the cupboard this week with an interview telling how he spent his day, which apparently, according to him, involved getting the Prime Minister the paper in the morning, giving her a blow wave, and then he said, then I have to recover during the day and sit on the couch and watch Parliament, which usually puts you to sleep. And at night he ran her a bath. Cassandra, I think this article was meant to show there's no misogyny in the lodge. Didn't it just make Tim Matheson look like a loafer?
Well, I think it shows that Tim has a healthy, self-deprecating humour, which is the classic Aussie man style. Look, I think that even lefties had to admit that Margaret Whitlam put a really poor foot in mouth when she criticised Jeanette Howard. And I think that if we drag the Prime Minister's partner into these debates, we need to be very careful. Tim seems
You mentioned Margaret Whitlam. Let me just refresh people's memories. She accused Jeanette Howard, the wife of the then Prime Minister, of being useless and said, what on earth does she do with her time? She had a responsibility to put into the community. Well, how come the same comments haven't been made of Tim Matheson?
Well, good question. But, I mean, Tim would be wise to keep his head down, let's face it, and I don't want to take a pot shot at him. The fact of the matter
is, I think it's just double standards. It's sexism.
It is, of course it is.
Because women are expected in the lodge to do something, support charities and all that. I don't think we have quite the same. I know he does the men's shed and something on diabetes, but he doesn't seem to be under the same pressure as a woman would be to prove themselves.
No, I wish you were right. I wish you were right. But the fact is that Tammy Fraser, Hazel Hawke, every partner has always been in the spotlight. They have always been abused by the other side. They've always been dragged into these
nasty... Hazel was not abused by the other side. Australia's darling.
Look, this all goes back to one simple thing, and that is, that Julia Gillard should never have made a baseless attack on Tony Abbott about misogyny. The reason she's pulled out Tim is because this is an answer to Maggie Abbott, who put up a very good performance, obviously, in the day or two that she decided to defend her husband. None of this should have happened in the first place, and the person I blame is Julia Gillard. She wanted to make it a personality fight, you know, with the spouses, and no one's interested in that in Australia, and she should learn a lesson from it. And if she puts Tim up again, I tell you what, someone will, you know, knock his head off, and he won't enjoy it, and nor should he.
Well, when you put your... As you say, he invited this scrutiny by putting himself up to show no sexism in the lodge, and... You cop it. Peter Reith, Cassandra Wilkinson, thank you so much for joining me.